Manti Te'o.
Now, this name is buzzing around the internet today. Now, some may have heard of his name way before the Netflix special that just came out recently, and some may know his name from when he was a powerhouse linebacker for Notre Dame and then the NFL for a little bit. Now, I want to talk about this because Manti Te'o is a very intriguing story. It deals with being used, gaslight, his mental health being completely shattered because of an incident that involved another individual pretending to be his girlfriend. Now, however you may know his name, there's a lesson we can take from this in the psychological fields. And as usual, in my fast, we're gonna break it down. Now, we're gonna go over some topics dealing with hindsight bias, athletic identity, mental toughness, and overall mental health values that we can take from this experience and something that Manti himself had to deal with. And I'm gonna go through it as usual through psychology and science. With that being said, let's break it down.
His grandmother and girlfriend, Lene Kakua, had died the same night. He dedicated his season to them. It was an amazing story.
I mean, they were with me, you know. I miss them.
One problem, his girlfriend did not exist.
He'll never say it affected his play, but you could definitely see something was up.
We just thought, what sick joke is someone trying to put on us?
My uncle immediately said, I think you're getting catfished.
It became evident that we had a major story.
I was afraid this was going to affect my NFL future.
I don't think he had any concept of how much the media will build you up and then tear you down.
That's when everything went chaotic.
I love you so much.
There were two people. It was crazy.
My whole world changed, and I'm questioning everything.
So like I mentioned, the recent Netflix Untold story on Manti Te'o has been buzzing and bringing his name back to popular media in about 10 years since this came up back in 2013. And people are seeing another side of the story, because originally when they heard about it, he was thrown under the bus as, how could you be so naive? How could you let someone do this to you? Especially when you're about to be a millionaire in the NFL. It just seemed ridiculous that someone of his stature, not just a celebrity status, his athletic status, but just common sense, could be played like a fool and get catfished. Now, I want to look deeper into that and go over some different topics that prevailed to me while watching this Netflix documentary.
The football field, that was my domain. You know, like when I'm on the football field, I feel like nobody can beat me. And I played free and I played fast and I played physical. And that was what made me great.
Now, one of the first ones is athletic identity. Now, in the sports psychology world, athletic identity is a person's resonation with being an athlete. So this can refer to a multitude of things, such as what does your social circle look like? A lot of times athletes hang out with other athletes, typically their teammates in the same sport, right? So if he's a football player, probably most of his friends were on the football team. But even in case of when they're not your own teammates, it's probably athletes on other teams. Even myself, when I was an athlete, if it wasn't someone on my track team or football team, it might have been someone on the baseball team. You just connect on that level because they can understand, especially at the student athlete level, of what you're dealing with. Getting up early for school, then going to practices, meetings, then the actual performances and games. So you just collectively understand each other. But another component of athletic identity that could be good is, how strongly do you identify yourself as a competitor? Someone wants to perform at the highest level. This is needed, especially when you're talking about being a champion, being a force, someone that wants to go to the highest level, in this case, the NFL for Manti. So you need that edge, but there's a double-edged sword to this, because if you identify too high as an athlete, that's when you start blending your actual personality to being caught up with what you do on the field or the court, equivalent to what you do outside of it. And this can be detrimental because you take a loss way more harder than you probably should. Yes, you should have some feeling when things don't go your way in a game because you're that much tied to it. You're compassionate. But if you equate losing a game, a match, a performance being bad to you being less of a person, this is when it goes too far. And that could be the hard side with many athletes deal with of all levels, from the little leagues all the way to the pros, because that's what got you there. That tenacity, that ability to just take over and dominate and get in the zone, is the same thing that could bring you down, because every loss is felt at a core level. And once you start equating that to your actual being, you could lose sight of who you really are. There's a saying that says an athlete dies twice. Now, the first funeral is obviously when the career ends. Sometimes it's at the high school level. If you're fortunate to go to college, then you can go on to that point, but then it'll end at the pro level. And if you're fortunate enough to go to the pro level, it'll eventually stop and you have to assimilate back to regular life. Probably the further that you go, you can say that this is more detrimental to your ability to go back to non-athletic living. and this is usually hard, and I've worked with athletes from the NFL to MMA to basketball that have retired from the pro level, and it's not always an easy transition. But you can see this in the film, because a lot of times Manti was seen as a leader of the team, the guy on campus that's this big football player. There's even a clip where one of the female students said she was scared to even talk to him because he's just this big, bad football guy.
You know him?
Nope.
Have you seen him?
Yeah.
Have you talked to him?
No.
Why?
Because he's scary.
Why?
Because he's really good at football, so that's intimidating.
You can understand if the people outside of his circle see him like that, imagine what his friends, his family see him as, and even himself, because he knows the pressures. He knows that he was expected to come in and help Notre Dame win immediately.
Manti Te'o is a kid, his reputation preceded him. Notre Dame had huge expectations of him before he even stepped onto campus. There was an expectation that he was going to make an impact the moment that he arrived in South Bend, and it was a lot of pressure.
They talk about this a lot during the film because they put a lot of faith into him. They brought him over from Hawaii. He was someone that doesn't really assimilate to that particular culture on the forefront, but he definitely could play some football. And that could be the struggle because he's already dealing with identity issues with fitting in just normal life. And you just time to only being a football player. That's hard for any individual to deal with. And this is why when I work with my clientele, whether it be young student athletes all the way to the pros, I want them to know that you have a life outside of sport. Granted, sport is what got you there, but an athlete is what you are, not who you are. And I use that saying because what you are means the task that you carry out day to day to perform. Who you are is that inner being, that traits, that personality. That means, are you a loving person? Are you confident? Are you someone who is goal-oriented and driven? Yes, these can intermingle with each other, but you have to be you before you're anything else.
The girlfriend never even existed.
It turns out that girl apparently never existed.
That's right. There was no woman by that name.
It was baffling.
It does rank among the most wild off-field items we've seen in recent times in college football.
I think one of the first questions that everybody asked is, how could he be so naive?
While Manti's athletic career is obviously the reason we know who he is, the big point of this documentary was to see the backstory and behind the scenes of what really transpired now 10 years later of what happened between his fake alleged girlfriend that died and made national news as a success story, but then quickly turned to a scandal when they found out she didn't exist. Now, how does this tie into something we call hindsight bias? Well, let's look at what hindsight bias is. Now, if you know the term hindsight, that's the ability to see things after they have happened. You say, oh, I should have knew all along. But the thing is, now that they have happened, it's much easier to put the pieces together and tell a story. For example, if you use this in like a sporting event, after a team you like loses, you'll be like, oh, I knew they weren't going to win all along. But before that game, you didn't know how they were going to perform. You didn't know if the star player was going to have a good or bad game. But now that you've seen the outcome, it's easier for your brain to assimilate information. I've talked about schemas a lot. Schemas help jump to conclusions so our brain can make sense of the environment around it, so we don't have to think harder to an everyday occurrence or topic. So in this case, with sport, in the example given, you don't have to put much attention because you already knew what the outcome is. And people seem to overestimate their abilities to predict things once they already know the outcome, which is kind of uncanny that they would do that. But the same thing can be seen in Manti's case, because we're in 2022. FaceTiming is an everyday thing nowadays. But back then, FaceTime was new. The only things we really used was like Skype, things of that nature, which used a webcam to talk to people face to face that weren't near to us. Now, it's easier to say that now because catfish wasn't even a term back then. The movie came out in 2010.
My uncle immediately said, I think you're getting catfished. And that was the first time that somebody ever brought up the term catfish. I don't know what catfishing was. Even when he explained what it was, I still couldn't understand or what that even entailed.
So by the time that Manti had found out he was talking to a fake girlfriend, the term catfish had only been around for about 2 years. So we can say it now because that movie went on to become a hit TV show that still comes on today, over a decade later, and it's assimilated to our everyday life. But back then it wasn't common. I can even speak on my own self because I wouldn't have thought of that. Obviously you can question things such as, why did he think that this person was real since they never saw them in real life? It's easy to say that now, but back then that wasn't uncommon. Remember pen pals? When you write someone, you wouldn't even talk to them. So even back then that could seem even more far-fetched. So to think that something as simple as having a text convo and that's it, because people say online dating is way more common, but back then online dating wasn't that accepted. Yes, it took place, but usually it was under the table, like you would lie about how you met. So in this case, you can maybe speculate he shouldn't have been naive. He should have knew, but that's easy to say because we know all the information after the fact, along with a full Netflix documentary to go with it. It's easy to make those calls. People say they feel no sympathy. It's not to say you should feel sorry for him, but he was definitely gaslighted as well. So no matter how you want to spin it, whether you think he was naive and a fool for falling for this, or you think he got played, it doesn't matter. We know what happened now, so it's easier to make that judgment call.
I walked down to the beach and I just started bawling. I had a decision, man. I was like, you can pout, but you got a whole family over there celebrating you, dude. Like, go spend it with them. So I walked back over there, I hugged all of my family. We were like, man, we're gonna get picked up tomorrow.
With the 38th selection in the 2013 NFL Draft, the San Diego Chargers proudly select Manti Te'o, linebacker, Notre Dame.
So if you've seen some of my other videos, you know I talk a lot about mental toughness. And in the performance psychology world, we use this term a lot. And it has many definitions, but it's basically being able to have an optimal performance as consistently as possible, regardless of the standards. It's not always gonna go your way. You're not always gonna have the best outcome, but can you be persistent and consistent and keep going regardless? If you see a hurdle, you step over it. It doesn't mean you're nervous or not afraid. It just means that you understand the ramifications of what you need to do and you make it happen regardless. You saw this happen. He found out that his grandmother and girlfriend both died. He still went to play in the game. Now, we now know, like I mentioned with hindsight bias, that only one of those things happened. But regardless, he didn't know that at the time. And even if you just want to go off his grandmother passing, that's a lot to handle emotionally, and he was able to execute. Now, the crazy thing is, later on, you could see during his career and even when he got to the NFL, he was affected by the stress and the pressures. He mentioned how almost every game for his pro career with the Chargers, 3 years, they had these nervousness, this tingle, his whole body went numb.
When I stood on that sideline and I looked across the field, My feet just started to go numb. And it slowly went up my legs till everything was tingling. And I remember my fingers started to sweat. And like everything just started to go numb. Numb. First 3 years with the Chargers was like that. 3 years.
Talk about performance anxiety or just a fight or flight response, you gotta understand the perception of stress, whether it's real or not, can cause a lot of psychological breakdown. You're probably thinking, this is a big guy, he goes around bigger guys all the time, hitting them full speed, and this is what breaks them down, and that's the power of the mind. Now, you see some parts where his parents talk about he didn't look like the Manti they knew, or he was missing tackles, whatever it may be. And this happens mostly because when we talk about cognitive load or even choking under pressure, your brain's focusing on a lot of different things that are relevant.
And I remember praying, don't mess up, bro. Just please make a play today. Just make a play, just make a play. And every time I was stepped on that line, that anxiety would build up again. Right, it's just like, don't mess up, bro. Like, don't mess up, don't miss tackles. Like, are you sure you know what you're doing?
So if you're worried about, why am I feeling this way? Why am I so stressed? I don't think I want to be here. I'm questioning who I am. This can affect you on the field because now you're not focused on where's that running back coming from? Where's that receiver going in the flats? That's the relevant information. We talk about things like working memory, be able to process information real time while transforming long-term memory aspects so you can make a decision and execute. If this is being interrupted because he's taking that energy away and going to, why am I nervous? I question if I should even be here. Talk about imposter syndrome. Imagine the whole world thinking you are a phony, a fraud, a fake. And now that you're here, they lost their trust. And now you're confirming that through bad play. So that just adds even more fuel to the fire and make you perform worse. So choking under pressure is actually a cognitive breakdown and actually makes you overanalyze movements, something called paralysis by analysis. And then you start emphasizing things that you know routinely, which is a waste of cognitive load or energy on the actual task at hand. This is a lot of time what goes into why people mess up under pressure. And a lot of this pressure was coming directly from him. Obviously, executing to the highest level in the NFL, everyone needs to do that, but he added even more on his plate on top of the expected expectations as an NFL player that came along with it on top of what he was already putting on himself. Now, there is instances where he does pull himself together. There was a scene where he was at his draft party waiting to be called and he wasn't getting called. The first round ended and he was distraught. He was originally going to be a top 20 pick and his name wasn't called at all in the first round. And if you know football, that's guaranteed money, millions that he would have gotten, but now he won't. So he went away from his family, but he said he had to be strong for them. He knew what they were counting on. And regardless of what he was going through, he had to hold it together. So he went back inside. And throughout this whole documentary, you can see the conviction on Manti's face that he really took this to heart and he's probably still dealing with it. But the beauty is he reached out, he saw a therapist, he understood more about what was going on. And a very impactful part of the movie was that the therapist asked, did he forgive Ronaya? He said, of course he did. Okay, simple response, but he went one step further and it may seem so minute, but the therapist asked,
have you forgiven yourself? And I looked at him, I was like, what do you mean forgive myself? He's like, have you forgiven yourself? I said, forgiven myself for what? For you to go through what you went through? Deep down inside, you're questioning yourself. You have to forgive that kid. It's okay, Oos. What happened to you is not your fault. It's okay. Forgive that kid.
And that's the beauty of therapy. It's not about having all the answers or solutions or being able to talk to you. It's about making you realize, how can I resolve things? Or even knowing that it can be resolved. And I'm sure that was a prolific moment for him because he beat himself up. That can go back to why he was stressing on the field with the Chargers, because he thought, how could I let them down? He seems to be a guy who really holds himself to a high regard, not because he's ego-driven. He seems to be very task-oriented. He wants to do right by his people, his family, by God. He wants to hold steady and be able to execute to make better life for people around him. And this makes sense why he would beat himself up, because as a leader, you have to understand there's a lot on your shoulder. And sometimes it can go the other way. You beat yourself up too much and not understand you can make mistakes. And he finally realized that he did, but it was okay. And I'm sure that's probably the time he started opening up and figuring out there's more life to be lived. Now, there's a lot we could take from this video. There's a lot to be taken from this documentary. Manti Te'o, shouts out to you. You went through a lot and I commend you. You held it together for your family and the ones that really matter. So with that being said, make sure you check it out if you haven't checked out the documentary. Make sure you like, comment, and subscribe to this video. I really want to know your thoughts, guys. This one really hit home as a former athlete and also being in the performance and sports psychology field in my profession. I really understand watching this, what he was really going through, and understand the accountability he took up despite what happened on the other person's side, Renaya. Big ups to Manti Te'o. Shouts out once again. Best of luck to you, your family, and your future endeavors. Now, as usual, guys, I appreciate you. Let me break it down. And as always, get your mind right.